Got your system?
Y'all want to see me play it backwards? The message, so you never know what you're gonna get, right?
I mean, when I gave up teaching to join the CIA, I thought everything was gonna be different. I thought I was gonna be this amazing spy. I'm just the same boring person I was before.
Well, for what it's worth, I think you're brilliant as you are. I mean, look, okay. What's really so different between us and Karen Walker?
I think literally everything.
No, how long? No, because you were just as good as her at the Academy.
She's had more successful missions than even Fine.
Oh, she's the worst. Look at her. She thinks she's so perfect, isn't she? Well, hi, I'm Karen Walker.
Super spy.
Perfect hair, perfect face. She probably cries herself to sleep every night.
I don't think she probably does.
She probably does. And not like sort of cute little tears, like really sort of, you know, silent kind of big.
I don't.
Like a sort of upside down kidney bean. This is what I look like when I'm asleep.
She won't know who we are. She's so full of herself.
Just. Hi, hey Nancy. Hi, Susan.
Hi.
All right. You don't love God if you don't love your neighbor. If you're gossip about them and you don't have mercy. Loving people requires some things we should do and some things we should not do. Galatians 5:26. Let's not become boastful, challenging another, envying one another. If we don't do the things we should do and do the things we should not do, we don't love God or people. 1 John 4:20, whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. Whoever does not love their brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. If the greatest commandment is to love God, Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And if the second commandment is proof of the first, and the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself, it would be equally important to love people as it is a display of our genuine love for God. John 13:35, by this everyone will know who you are, that you are my disciples, by how much you know your Bible. Is that what it says? By how many homeless people you feed? By all the wonderful things you do? No. And those are attached to loving people, but that's not how you'll be known. You'll be known for your love for one another. Right? It all comes down to this. Loving God puts on display by loving people.
It all comes down. My neighbor as myself.
if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends.
All right, so announcements, baptisms, you're really pushing it at this point. You know? All right, well, you know, I do have a guy doing it tomorrow, so we'll see. If he shows up, I'll do it. So we're going to do, this message, we're going to do a little review of last week's, because it's really to pull this section of the Bible where it talks about love together. And a lot of times we just kind of read over it quickly, and I really want to break it down over a series of messages. And I'll move at the speed, you know, the Holy Spirit allows. Like this, when I hit 70 slides, it's done. Like, anything beyond that, I'm just really pushing. You know, I'm pretty fast going as it is, so I'm trying to limit it in that number of slides instead of trying to just complete what I'd like to get done. Because honestly, when I'm preaching, there's so many points I want to get across, but as I'm limited to amount of time. So you guys are getting, you know, 15 to 20 hours of work in 45 minutes, and you understand that you're not going to walk away with it all, but you can rewatch it or at least get what you get out of it, right? So this week we want to talk about, last week you talked about things love does, right? We want to talk about things love does not do, right? So as we do this series, right? And so the title of the message today is If I Didn't Love You. So it's kind of a spin. That's why I did the spin. Anyway, everything's thinking here. So let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we thank you for your word. And we thank you. It's just such a great foundation, Lord. If we just grasp it and apply it to life, God, it would change everything. And so help us to do that, Lord, with this amazing topic, Lord, of love. In Jesus' name, Lord. Amen. So, if I love God, these are facts. If I love God, I would love you. Right? If I didn't love God, I wouldn't love you. If I didn't love you, there would be some things I would do. And if I didn't love you, there would be some things I wouldn't do. So genuine love has evidence. Evidence of love found in action. We can know what love is as a noun, but until we put it into action, it's useless knowledge and it means nothing. And that's why Paul says that. Everything is nothing. You can know more than me about the Bible, but it means nothing without love, right? You can be some, you know, you could be a person, I feed about 80 people at the homeless thing every week. You could feed 100. It means nothing without love. It's not about how much or how much more. It's how it's applied that's really going to be effective in life, what, if it really means something. Right? That's why Paul said this. If I have the gift of prophecy and I can fathom all mysteries and I have all knowledge, he's talking about if I understand everything in that Bible, I get it, man. And I have faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love. It means nothing. I am nothing in the end. All right? Love without action is just empty words. And that's why Jesus says this. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And you're going to run across people like that. People who honor you with their lips, but their hearts are far from you. And that shows up down the road, by the way. Right? But that, there's people like that. You know, they're very friendly here, but their hearts are far from you. Don't be surprised. I mean, they're doing it with Christ. They're going to do it with you. If I love God, there are some things I would do. John 14:15, Jesus said, if you love me, you'll what? You do what I say. You obey my command. Listen, every relationship has rules. We may not always state them, but here's the thing. I'm in a relationship with you ladies, but I'm only going to cheat on you once in a while. Is that okay? No, all right, you're my friend, and I'm going to steal off you because I know you'll forgive me. You get my point? No. If you're acting out of love, I wouldn't want to do those things because I love you. And that's what Christ is trying to get us in a relationship with him. You shouldn't be going, yeah, I'm saved, I can get away with it. You see, that's really showing you your love relationship with Christ is. You shouldn't want to offend somebody who's done everything he's done for you. You should act out of love. And that's why Jesus makes a statement like this. If you love me, you would do, you would keep my commands. And you'd be keeping them in the right way. Not a duty. Because if you're doing it out of duty, the chances are you will not continue, right? And there are some things I would do, 2 Timothy 2:15, if I loved you, be diligent to present yourselves approved to God as a worker who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth. Study to show yourself approved to God. Talking about studying the Bible. Why do you do that? One who does not need to be ashamed, who can correctly explain God's word to other people, right? If I love God, I would do this, approved unto God. Right? I would read and study the Bible so I could correctly explain it to other people. Not so I can go around stating a bunch of facts. Right? There are some things I would do. Well, 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. I would spend time with prayer and God every day. I don't run across many Christians who struggle with this one. You know, because prayers are all about going, hey God, could you give me this? Right? We don't have a problem with praying. But boy, I'll tell you, the things that require some labor on our part, we struggle more with. But that's what tests our relationship with God. That's what tests our love relationship with God. All right? And so whenever you come up with a reason why you don't do something God wants you to do, it's really this, it's your love that's out of line. All right? You know, when you love someone, you want to do things for them. It should be natural. There are some things I would do, right? Let's not neglect meeting together as some people have made a habit. Right? Doing things God, not doing things God wants you to do, can become a habit, you know. Right? But let us encourage one another, and let us, and all the more as you see the day. That's about talking about the church, right? And what does the next verse say? If we deliberately keep on sinning after we receive the knowledge of the truth, there's no sacrifice for sins left. See, if I love God, I'd go to church. I wouldn't come up with reasons why I couldn't go. I'm going because I love him. I may not like the message every week. I might not like the guy giving the message. But you know what? I love God. And I'm going to go to church. Right? There are some things I would do. Jesus said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Go into all the world and preach the good news to everyone. I would tell people about Jesus. If you love somebody, you usually talk about them to other people, don't you? That's what God's saying. If you love me, you will do these things. Right? I would be thankful. And let the peace of God come from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful. I tell you, it's easy to be thankful when life is good. But that's not what that command is. I'm always going to be thankful because Christ has done enough, right? I would praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Does that leave anybody out there? And I would love people, and that's part of the commandment of this. And that's really where we're focusing today is love your neighbor as yourself. And I could go on and on and on with the different things God says to do, right? There's two types of sin, you know that? And really, sin is you breaking your love relationship with Christ. Is when he tells us, God says, do this, do this, do this, do this. And then he says, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. And sometimes Christians are more guilty of the things they should be doing instead of the things they shouldn't be doing. And when they're not doing when they're doing the things they shouldn't be doing, and they see somebody else doing it, they're so critical about them, but they're missing so many of the things they should be doing. Kind of a play on words, right? We're so easy to be attacking somebody else when we know in our own lives, if we really took a good look at it, we're just breaking it on the other end. All right, talk is cheap. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. You can talk Christ all you want. You know, the test of your love relationship with him, that's your walk with God. Remember that. Your walk with God. Your test of your love for God is always going to be dependent on how obedient you choose to be with what he tells you to do. Actions are love. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll obey my commands. It's real simple, right? And just like there are actions of love and the things we should do, 1 Peter 4:10, each of you should, that's part of the scriptures, right? Use whatever gift you receive to what? Serve others, right? That's a message in and of itself right there. I'll break a little bit into that, but I don't have much for time's sake, Right? God doesn't give you gifts for you to get glory for yourself. He gives you gifts to share with others, to draw people to Christ, right? Every gift God has given you should be used to serve Him in what? Love for others. That's why He gives you the gifts, so you can do what He's telling you to do. Right? There are actions of love in things we shouldn't do. Right? So we have the should-dos, but there's also actions in love and things we shouldn't do. Leviticus 18:22. Do not what? Have sexual relations with a man as one does with a woman. That is what? Abomination. Right? If I love God, I wouldn't do this. And because this is put there, all love is not love. That's lust. It's not love. If I love God, there are things I wouldn't do. You shouldn't have no other gods before me. And we don't live in a day and age where people bow down before statues. I mean, some do. You still got the Buddhists and things like that going on out there, right? We probably live in a day and age where we put things, pleasures, and things like that above God. Those become our idols. If you come up with a reason why you don't keep God's commands, that's your idol. Whatever you've put in there. Whatever reason you came up with. If I really love God, I wouldn't put anyone or anything above Him. I'd honor Him at all times of my life, or at least put forth that effort, right? Things I wouldn't do. Exodus 27, you shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses His name. You know, I cringe when I hear people do that, and when they're unsaved, I say, God, forgive them, like Christ said, forgive them, right? They don't know you yet. But boy, to hear a Christian use God's name in vain, and it's not always using His name in vain. Sometimes it's... We have actions that abuse His name, right? I wouldn't disrespect God's name with vocabulary or actions. Let me give you an example of actions. Let's say on the back of my truck I had Jesus saves, and I'm raging at you at the wall, shaking my fist at you across from me. I'm bringing reproach on God's name. I don't know. So sometimes our actions, that's why I don't put a Jesus saves on the back of my truck. Right? I know me, right? You get my point. You can bring reproach upon God's name by more than just your words, but by your action. Oh, I heard they were a Christian. Not that we're perfect, but we should be at least putting forth that effort, right? Because why? Why? Because God says so? No, because we love Him, and He says so. All right? Things I wouldn't do. You shall not murder. Well, that's a pretty good one for us all, right? I would not kill people with malicious intent. That does not mean you can't kill somebody at war if you were defending your family. There's certain sections where God does draw back on that law, but you shouldn't be planning it out. Now, I hope you guys follow that when you think of me, right? And, you know, and I in turn won't kill you, right? So that's love. Things I wouldn't do. You should not steal. If I love you, I'm not going to steal off you. Things I wouldn't do. You must not lie. This is a big one. I'll tell you, you know, we get those little, oh, how's my haircut? Ugh. Does this dress make me look fat? It doesn't leave any leeway in that. So if you're in a position like that, say, oh, I gotta go, right? I don't get this. I really don't get this thinking. Like, so if I was wearing some shirt and it was really horrible and I asked you what you thought and you went, oh, Joe, that shirt is just ugly. I wouldn't get mad at you for it, but people do. They ask, but they don't want the truth, right? I'd rather hear the truth myself, so don't be afraid to tell me, right? But you know, God doesn't want us lying. Even the smallest lies, He doesn't want us doing it. Because when you start compromising on the small ones, you'll compromise on the larger ones. And why do you do it? Why don't you do this? Because you love Him. I would not covet, you shall not covet. I would not hate, do not nourish hatred in your heart. I would not love money and things, keep your lives free from the love of money. I would not love the world or the things therein. That means putting them above God, by the way. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And on I could go. If you've read any of your Bible, you know a lot of the things God has said to do and not to do, right? The fact is, relationships have rules attached to them. If you're in a relationship with someone, you expect some kind of dedication for them to follow those rules. And every time they break those rules, it breaks the relationship a little bit, doesn't it? Right? If I love Jesus, there are things I wouldn't do. And that's why He said this, if you love me, obey my commands. So you look at it from a different angle when you see it that way, don't you? And I don't know about you, but when I break God's commands, it breaks my heart. I go, God, I'm sorry. That's what we should do with people we love too, right? And this is proof of our love. Those who accept my commandments, and here's the first part of this verse, you have to be able to accept them. A lot of people come up with excuses why they do what they do instead of just accepting it and going, you know what, I'm wrong, right? You accept it. I talked to some people, you know, just different topics. Let's say premarital sex, that's a big one today. If you bring it up, people have always a reason why they do things God says not to do. And I always say the same thing. So if there's another topic you disagree with, you're going to say that was just for back then too? You get my point. There's something wrong with your love relationship with God when you're doing things you know He doesn't want you doing. Right? Things we shouldn't do. And we can't obey His commands without loving people. Galatians 5:14. This is where we're really focusing here. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command. This is huge. What's he saying? This is big, man. This is the biggest one here. Love your neighbor as yourself. And why does he say that? Listen, this is why. Because most of God's commands are how to act in love towards people. You know, when God says a lot of these things, he's telling you how to act towards people. There's very few, actually, commandments on how you act towards him. Most of them are how your actions are towards people. So when he says, thou shalt not murder, you're not going to kill God. He's talking about you, how you deal with people. He's teaching you how to love. Right? And so you shall not murder people, you shall not lie to people, you shall not steal from people, you shall not covet what people have, you shall not hate people, you shall not cheat people, you shall not lust for people, you shall not commit adultery on people, you shall not help people, you shall help people, you shall serve people, you shall love people, you shall give to people, you shall. There's you shall nots and there's you shalls, all part of relationships in love. And God's commanding us to love people. So whatever reason you come up that you dislike that person, you're breaking God's commands. And there's something wrong with your love for God. Because when we love God, we apply it in spite of how we feel. Matthew 22:39. And the second greatest commandment is like this. Love your neighbor as yourself. We love God, we will keep his commands. If we love God, we will fulfill God's commands. If we love people, we prove that we love God. God's commands are only fulfilled when we apply them with love towards people.
Love your neighbor as yourself is one of Scripture's best known principles. Of course, people tend to forget that the prior command is love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. It can be humanly challenging to love our neighbors if our hearts aren't first as they should be in loving God. In the first five books of the Old Testament, love your neighbor is only mentioned one time. But love of strangers is noted 36 times. Biblically, a neighbor is any other human being, including strangers. The United States is a multiracial, multi-ethnic country, a nation of immigrants. So it would seem God's command to love strangers is as applicable for us as it was for the ancient Israelites. We're often told today to exercise tolerance toward others in society. But this seems to me to be a lower standard than love your neighbor. Loving our neighbors is our business today. This is a nonpartisan command.
Just like loving God has rules, loving people has rules. All right, 1 Corinthians 13:4-8, that's why this is penned. And this is penned in one of the most corrupt churches there are. That's why Paul puts this in this church. They just didn't love. All right, 1 Corinthians 13:4 is really what we're concentrating on, but this goes on to 4:8. It says, love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it's not self-seeking, it's not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with truth. It always protects, it always trusts, it always hopes, it always perseveres. Love never fails. This is love in action, which means the rules are God's commands. And these rules that he's giving you are to be applied to people. There are things we must do to love people. We talked about these two last week. Love is patient, love is kind, right? Things we must put into action. Agape love is active, not abstract or passive. It does not simply feel patient, it practices patience. It does not merely have kind feelings, it does kind things. Love is fully loved only when it acts. God didn't pen that for you to just go, oh, that's what love looks like. No, he penned that for you so you apply it in spite of how you feel. Yeah, if you don't understand that patience is going to have to be in spite of how you feel, you don't understand love. And God's saying these things need to be put into action in your life. things we must do. Love is patient. So this is a little review of some of the things we talked about last week. And the reason I'm doing that is because it all fits together. And as we go through this, and I'm going to do as many messages as it takes for me to get through this entire passage on love, because it's the greatest thing we could do. Love is patient, love is kind, right? So with this part, we're looking at love is patient, long-suffering, long-tempered. Love's patience is the ability to be inconvenienced or taken advantage of by a person over and over again and yet not get upset and angry. Now, here's the thing. I don't know how any of us could never get upset or angry, right? But what that this verse would more angle towards is you may get upset and angry, but in spite of that, you don't act on it. You control that temper, and you still remain kind in spite of how you feel, right? The action of love. You're putting out the action of love in spite of how you feel. There's no way patience could not work that way in your mind. So remember, the guy's not getting out of my way in the highway, and I'm getting angry at him, and I go, love is patient, and I back up. Right? So we act on it in spite of how we feel. Patience trusts God is in control of all circumstances. It'll work out. Never take your own revenge. It leaves no room for us, right? But leave room for the wrath of God. Leave room to let God take control of it. God wants to do something, let him do it, but it's not going to be me. I'm just going to love and be patient with this person. All right? Love practices patience. Don't repay evil for evil. Don't retaliate with insults when people insult you. Instead, pay them back. Whoa, I told you, we talked about that. Now it comes to another level. We're not only going to just tolerate it, we're actually going to be kind in return. Whew. That'll have a strong effect on anybody. Let me tell you something. When you return kindness for evil, the Bible says those who reward evil for good, evil will follow them all their days. And so we just trust God to it. That is what God has called what? You to do. It doesn't leave any of us out, right? And then what? He attaches us. And if you do that, God's going to look down and go, whoa, you're loving like my son. I'm going to bless you for that. All right? Patience proves love. 2 Corinthians 6:6. We prove ourselves by our purity, our understanding, and what? Our patience. That's our proof, right? And by the Holy Spirit within us. That's how we do it, right? And by what kind of love? Sincere love. Now you're loving with God's love. If I'm going to love people, I am going to have to be patient, right? Things we must do. And then the next thing it says, love is kind. Remember, it's always in predominant order because you cannot be impatient and be kind. You can't. The only thing that will come out after that, when you're impatient, is bad things. If I'm going to love, I must put kindness into action. Kindness in action. A person who has friends must themselves be what? Friendly. Say, I don't have any friends. Well, wait, maybe you need to start showing yourself a little friendly, right? Why doesn't anybody want to hang around me? You're probably a jerk. Right? I'm always a jerk to you. You say, hey, you want to hang out? Want to go grab some lunch together? No. Right? You want to have friends? Show yourself friendly. That's showing kindness, right? If you're kind to people, you'll draw people to you, right? And then you can use that for Christ, right? Kindness. Just as patience will take anything from others, kindness will give anything to others, even its enemies. Being kind is the counterpart of being patient. To be kind is to be helpful, serving, and gracious. It is active goodwill. It not only feels generous, it is generous. It not only desires others' welfare, but it works for it. Acts 28:2. The people of the island were very kind to us. Why? They showed action. It was a cold, rainy day, so they built us a fire on the shore, and they welcomed us. It doesn't take a whole lot to be kind to people. You see a need, do something, show some kindness. These weren't even saved people. Sometimes unsaved people can be kinder than Christians or people who claim Christianity, right? Patience and kindness are proof of genuine love. 2 Corinthians 6:6, we prove ourselves by our purity, our understanding, our patience, I left this out last time, and our kindness. Patience, kindness, they have to fall hand in hand by the Holy Spirit within us, by our sincere love. That's what sincere love is. And there are ways to tell if people love you. There are ways. You want to test your relationship with somebody? You want to see if somebody really loves you? Well, love is patient, love is kind. Right? If I didn't love you, I wouldn't be patient with you, and I wouldn't be kind to you. Right? And we're going to do this as a memory verse. We're going to break this down, because we're going to be going through this over the next, I don't know how many weeks it'll take me to get through this, right? So we're going to do this three times. We're going to say this. So it's 1 Corinthians 3:4. You don't have to put through 8 in there yet. And all we're going to say is love is patient, love is kind, three times. All right, first, we're together. 1 Corinthians 13:4, love is patient, love is kind. 1 Corinthians 13:4, love is patient, love is kind. 1 Corinthians 13:4, love is patient, love is kind. Now close your eyes. You guys say it. 1 Corinthians 13:4, love is patient. Oh, I seen somebody with their eyes open over there, Jim. Listen, if you can memorize any verse in the Bible, considering this is the greatest thing we could do, this could be the greatest verse you could remember. It'll correct your thinking. If you can carry that this week, it'll change the way you react to people. There are always ways to tell people don't love. Right? These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Without these two positive descriptions of love put into action, there's only lip service. Right? And just like love has things we should do, it has things we shouldn't do. That's where we're headed today. 1 Corinthians 13:4, love does not envy, right? Or love is not jealous. It goes hand in hand, these two. I wouldn't love you if I was envious or jealous of you. Paul gives us two positive descriptions of love and kindness, right? The next, he gives us a description of 8 negatives. Isn't that funny? 2 positives, and now he's going to give you 8 negative aspects of love that if you do these things, you don't love. Envy is listed first on these 8 negatives, which means it's the one that leads to the others and probably the most difficult for us to deal with. I think most sins come out of envy in one way or another. And just like patience leads to kindness, it is far more difficult to do, and that's why it's listed first. Envy and jealousy have been listed as the green monster, the enemy of honor, the sorrow of fools, and Jesus referred to it as an evil eye. All right, 1 Corinthians 13:4, love does not envy, love is not jealousy. Jealousy, hostile toward a rival or one believed to enjoy an advantage. Envy, painful or resentful awareness of an advantage enjoyed by another joined with a desire to possess the same advantage. Covetousness with malice, jealousy, begrudging, resentment. Jealousy has an origin just like lies. This is where envy comes from. And we say back in Isaiah, it says, but you, Satan, you said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit on the mount of the assembly in the recesses of the north. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. He envied God. And that's what drove him to his fall. Right? Love and jealousy are mutually exclusive. Where one is, the other cannot be. In 1 Corinthians 13:4, right? Jealousy or envy have two forms. One form says, I want what someone else has. The other form says, I wish they didn't have what they have. And jealousy left unchecked can lead to its second form. The second source of jealousy is desiring evil for someone else. And here's an example of that, right? Here we have Solomon, and we have the two women, right? And they're fighting over whose child this is. All right, he says, then the king said, bring me a sword. So they brought the sword to the king, and he then gave the order, cut the living child in two and give one half to one half to the other. Now, we know the outcome because we've read it, but imagine what you would be thinking when you heard that if you didn't know the outcome of this. And the woman whose son was alive was deeply moved out of love for her son and said, the king, please, my lord, give her the living child. Don't kill him. But the other said, boy, this is envy at its rudest point, right? Neither I nor I, but kill the kid. Give us half. That's where envy can drive you, right? Mm-hmm. This is jealousy at its most corrupt level. Galatians 5:17, for the flesh desires what is contrary to the spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They're in conflict with each other. Why? And so what's the advice here? You should not do whatever you want. Don't let envy drive you in life. Right? We all have the potential for being jealous, which means we all have the potential for choosing to hate or love. One of the hottest battles a Christian must fight is against jealousy. There's always someone who is a little better or who is potentially a little better than you are. We will face the temptation of jealousy when someone else does something better than we do. And the first reaction of the flesh is to wish that person ill. We're all going to struggle with it, right? You're doing something and somebody does a little better than you, you're like, that's right, you get that competition going on there, right? It can be a sure downfall for any of us. As they danced, they sang, and Saul has slain his thousands, and David has 10,000s. This made Saul very angry. He says, what is this? He said, they credited David with 10,000s and me with only thousands? Next, they'll be wanting to make him their king. So from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on David. There's the green eye, right? I got to keep my eye on this dude. Well, that guy preaches a little better than me. I'm going to keep my eye on them. They're going to want to get to church. Oh, that person does this better than me. I'm going to keep my eye on them. They're after my business. They're after my family. Jealousy can be the downfall of a church, right? This was written to unsaved. You want what you don't have, so you scheme and kill to get it. You're jealous of what others have. But you can't get it, so you fight and wage war and you take it away from them. Yet you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it.
And then when you do ask, you do not receive it because you ask with the wrong motives, and you may spend what you get on your own pleasures. God doesn't give you things for your own. He gives it so you can love and share that with others. Right? The Corinthian church is a great example of that, right? 1 Corinthians 13:4. That's why this verse is penned to the Corinthian church. The Corinthian church was all involved with envy of one another, they're competing with each other. The actions of love is not to be jealous. When love sees someone who is popular, successful, beautiful, or talented, it is glad for them and never jealous or envious. Paul gives us a great example of this. Philippians 1:15-17 says, this is Paul, now he's in prison at this point. He says, it's true that some are preaching out of jealousy and rivalry. So he's in prison, he's got some other people out there who are trying to outdo him, who's bad-mouthing him, and he's writing this letter about those particular people. It is true that some are preaching out of jealousy and rivalry, but others preach about Christ with pure motives. So some have the wrong motives, some have the wrong right motives. They preach because they love me, the one with the right motives, for they know I have been appointed to defend the good news. And those others with the wrong motives, out of envy, do not have pure motives as they preach about Christ. They preach with selfish ambition, not sincerely intending to make my chains more painful to me. He knew the message was more powerful than the messenger and that it could transcend weak and jealous preachers in order to accomplish his purpose. So what did he say? He wraps this all up and says to this, what? It doesn't matter to me. Whatever. Let them talk. Why? Whether their motives are false or genuine, the message about Christ is being preached either way. So I rejoice and I'll continue to rejoice. Christ is getting out there either way. And I'm here to glorify God, and that's really what's important to me. So if you want to be envy and jealousy and say a bunch of bad things about me, go ahead. It's not going to affect me. It was Eve's jealousy of God that Satan successfully appealed to her. But God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open and you will, what? He introduced envy in her heart. Jealousy. She wanted to be like God. Right? Mm-hmm. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good, she just took it, ate it, and gave it to her husband. Right? Mm-hmm. Right? It was Cain's jealousy of Abel that caused him to kill his brother. And Abel also brought an offering, fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. And the Lord looked down with favor on Abel and his offering. He said, good job, right? But Cain and his offering, he did not look favorable with. And so Cain was very angry. His face was downcast. And who did he take it out on? His brother. He went out and killed him. It was Joseph's brother's jealousy that caused them to plot to kill and sell him into slavery. Genesis 37, what's this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come down and bow down to the ground before you? And did they? Yes, but that's extra. His brothers were what? Jealous of him. That's what drove them to do what they did. It's Korah, Dathan, and Abiram's jealousy that caused them to rebel against Moses. They united against Moses and Aaron and said, you've gone too far. The whole community of Israel has been set apart by the Lord. And he is with us all. What right do you have to act as though you are greater than the rest of us and the Lord's people? And number 16, what happened to them? The earth came and swallowed them up. What led them to that? Jealousy. Envy. It was Absalom's jealousy that caused him to try to kill and take David's kingdom. This is Absalom talking. I wish I was the judge of the land. He was saying, I wish I was the king. And then he goes on to say, well, if I was the king, you know, anybody who had a problem, I would take care. He won over the hearts of Israel, right, and tried to kill his dad all out of envy and jealousy of his dad's position. It was Simon's jealousy that caused him to try to buy the ability to give the Holy Spirit. When Simon saw the Spirit was given by the laying on the apostles' hands, he offered them money to do the same thing. Why? Because he wanted people to go, oh, wow. That was the problem with the Corinthian church, by the way. They had the same problem as Simon. All right. And where he got straightened out, you have no part of the share of this ministry because your heart is not right before God. When your heart's in envy and jealousy and you're pursuing those things, your heart is not right before God. It was jealousy that caused the Corinthian church to be divided. First I hear that there's divisions among you when you meet as a church. When one of you says, I'm a follower of Paul, and another says, I'm a follower of Paul, it's not you acting like people of the world. After all, who's Apollos and who's Paul? We're only God's servants through whom you believe the good news. Each of us does work. Nobody's higher or lower. Nobody's higher or lower here. Why are you envying? Why? You have some gifts I don't. I have some gifts you don't. Why would we envy each other? Oh, I wish I had. I wish I could do that like him. Right? It was the Corinthian church's jealousy that caused them to chase gifts to draw attention to themselves. Listen to this. Tongues then are a sign not for believers but for who? Unbelievers. That's why tongues were simply this. I could speak another language so they understood the gospel. And they understood what I was saying. That's why it's for unbelievers. right? But they were chasing this ability because they thought that was greater than some of the other abilities, and they wanted everybody to think that they were great because they were doing this. Right? So if the whole church comes together and everyone speaks in tongues, which basically means languages, by the way, and inquiries or unbelievers come in, won't they say, are you nuts? Are you crazy? I'm glad I never went to a church that spoke in tongues before salvation, because if I ever seen that, I would have walked away and went, those people are crazy. That's exactly what Paul's saying, right? We ought to be chasing things to get glorified ourselves. We'd be using our gifts for God and God alone. Jealousy, envy, 1 Corinthians 3:3, you're still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Jealousy, envy, surely resentment destroys the fool and the jealousy kills the simple. And I saw that all the toil, And I saw that all the toil and all the achievements spring from one person's, what's he saying there? Do you realize that the reason why somebody builds a bigger building than the other building is because they envy that person and they want to be able to say, I built the bigger building, right? That's like me and my neighbor going back and forth planting plants. Like, I go plant a plant and he's out there, he's planting two. Oh yeah, I'm planting three next week. But I told you, he had a wife. They were like getting ahead of me and I couldn't keep up. But then the deer came over and he got all their tulips. And I said, thank you, God, I can stay ahead, right? All right, Proverbs 14:30, a heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones. Anger is cruel and fury is overwhelming. Those are really bad, but who can stand before envy? It's worse. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, you can read the rest of that verse. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and what? It always leads to bad things. That's what he's saying. Always leads to bad things. Envy or jealousy, listen, all these things come out of that. Rebellion, murder, theft, lies, gossip, lust, pride, selfishness, worldliness, vile practices. And since it is listed first in the things not to do with love, it probably leads to every type of sin in some way or some sort. Anger, resentment, and jealousy doesn't change the heart of others, it changes yours though. Resentment is like drinking poison and waiting for the other person to die. The only thing more frustrating than slander is those foolish enough to listen to them. Envy, after all, comes from wanting something that isn't yours, but grief comes from losing something you've already had. I mean, you got to think about that one a little bit. You're so eyed out looking for something you don't have, and then you lose something you do have, and you're going, oh, crap. And I like how this one points it out. There's a magnificent, beautiful, wonderful painting in front of you. It's intricate, detailed, painstaking labor of devotion and love. The colors are like no other. They swim and leap. They trickle and embellish. And yet you choose to fixate your eyes on a small fly which has landed on it. You're so focused on what you don't have, you're missing the beautiful picture of what is right in front of you. Why do people do such things? All right. Synonyms for jealousy: anxious, apprehensive, attentive, envious, intolerant, possessive, resentful, skeptical, suspicious, begrudging, covetous, demanding, doubting, green-eyed, guarded, mistrustful, monopolizing, possessory, questioning, rivaling. Antonyms, the opposite of that: calm, content, undoubting, unwearied, confident, satisfied, trusting, unresentful. How do you want to live? The enemy of jealousy, I'll tell you right now, what godliness actually is a means of great gain when accompanied by what? Contentment. Thank you, God, for what I have. Thank you for what they have. All right? Love puts contentment in action when jealousy shows up. And how are we supposed to be acting? What does the Bible say? Do everything in love. And there is no love with jealousy or envy. 1 Corinthians 13:4. Love is patient. Love is kind. What? Does not envy. All right? That's just one of the negative aspects of, I know that I can only do about 70 slides and then I'm pushing it. And I said, God, you get me as far as you want me to get through this, and that's it. You didn't let me get any further. Remember, because this is where the downfall of most sins come from. You want something that you don't have, right? So we're gonna do that one three times. We're just gonna add this in. By the end of this, we're gonna know this verse, right? 1 Corinthians 13:4 together. Love is patient, love is kind. First Corinthians 13. That's the hottest part of memory verses, by the way, is remembering where it is, or just so you know, right? 1 Corinthians 13:4. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not. One more time. 1 Corinthians 13:4. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy. Close your eyes, I'm gonna look, guys. 1 Corinthians 13:4. I'll tell you, if that's all you get this week, if you put that in your heart, you will act differently this week. And we're going to break down every part of this, and hopefully by the end we can memorize that verse and we can carry it. And I'll tell you, God says, if you can do that, that's the greatest thing you can accomplish. That will fulfill all the commandments I've given you. Because if you're doing that, the other things just won't happen, or they just will happen. If I didn't love you, I would not be patient with you. If I didn't love you, I would not be kind to you. If I didn't love you, I would be envious and jealous of you.
I mean, when I gave up teaching to join the CIA, I thought everything was going to be different. I thought I was going to be this amazing spy. I'm just the same boring person I was before.
Well, for what it's worth, I think you're brilliant as you are. I mean, look, okay. What's really so different between us and Karen Walker?
I think literally everything.
No, hang on, no, because you were just as good as her at the Academy.
She's had more successful missions than even Fine.
Oh, she's the worst. Look at her. She thinks she's so perfect, isn't she? Well, hi, I'm Karen Walker. Super spy. Perfect hair, perfect face. She probably cries herself to sleep every night.
I don't think she probably does.
She probably does. And not like sort of cute little tears, like really sort of, you know, silent kind of big. like a sort of upside down kidney bean. This is what I look like when I'm asleep.
Do you know who we are? Just in front of us.
Hi, hey Nancy. Hi, Susan.
Hi.
Oh, that's hilarious, isn't it? I couldn't find a better video than that one to explain it.
And it all comes down. What you require of me, love my neighbor as myself, and you above all things. Act justly, love mercy, walk humbly with you.
Song, it says, just remember this, every day we're one step closer to being home with God. We're going to be in our perfect, glorified bodies, and these things will no longer be a struggle for us. But the fruit
of what we sowed here will be brought out there. And God will reward you for loving like Christ. And everything you did with the right motive behind it, God someday will reward you for it. We know we can fulfill the greatest, we know we can't fulfill the greatest commandment without fulfilling the second greatest commandment. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother or sister whom they've seen cannot love God whom they've not seen. We can't fulfill the second greatest commandment if we're not patient and kind with people. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy. That's the addition this week. And we can't fulfill the second greatest commandment if we're envious or jealous of people. And this is really what it comes down to. God's already told us what it is, what to put in action. What will you choose to do? And really, that's. And why do you do the things you do for God? Because what? Because you love Him. What will you choose? Will you choose to act on love for God? Or will you just choose to choose the same things the enemy has chosen? You know, the reason why I don't get an H1, I know you guys would empty me and probably kill me. Right? So I'm protecting you by not getting it. Right? Real simple this week. Just apply love is patient, love is kind, and does not envy. Think about that this week when you're dealing with people. Right? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for your word, and we thank you, Lord, it's a sure foundation. Help us all to build our lives on these three principles for now, God. Love is patient, love is kind, and does not envy. And help us to apply that, God, because we love you. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.